Our next speaker is David Hammerstein. He's the Senior Advisor to the Transatlantic Consumer Dialogue on Intellectual Property.
Yes, before beginning, as I thought about this event, and thank you to KEI for organizing this event, I've been to a number of these events in Geneva, and there's someone missing at the table. It's Raoul Cherian, who's our beloved colleague who died a few months ago, who is a great, was a great lawyer and would have been a great person here at this conference, you know, supporting the right to disabled. He represented the group called
Inclusive Planet.
And I don't know, just coming to an event like this, I just, my first thought to my mind is thinking, where's Raoul? But he's in our hearts. In general, about what we're talking about, like I said the other day, this is not about balance. Everyone uses the word balance. It's not about balance. It's about correcting an historic imbalance. It's not about promoting market incentives, because it's about correcting a massive historic market failure that's failed terribly. And in general, many of the positions of the EU and the US have responded to positions that are not publicly known. If there was any degree of transparency, any degree of openness, any degree of democratic debate, the positions of the United States and the European Union would be diametrically different. And this has happened in the European Union. In the European Union, we've had a resolution of the European Parliament on this that's very, very clear in supporting the positions, most of the positions of the World Blind Union. It hasn't been followed by the negotiators. We've had a parliamentary debate last month in Strasbourg where every single speaker, over 20 members of the European Parliament, supported on the same issues we're talking about: commercial availability, TPMs, sending to individuals, etc., etc. They all supported the positions of the World Blind Union. European Union negotiators have not followed that in their negotiations. It makes you think, who are they working for? Who are they responding to? I respect individual economic interests. I respect industrial interests. They have a place in society. But when we're talking about a question of human rights, the common good has to take priority. The common good has to take priority. We're talking about a general injustice. It's generally a human rights issue, and that has to take priority this time. Okay, as far as the negotiation, I'm concerned about a few things. First of all, what is closed? Is it closed? The issue on TPM, is it closed? I thought we had the issue on authorized entities closed, and now I hear this proposal about putting some kind of intermediary responsibility or liability or accountability on the authorized entities when they send to individuals. I thought that was closed already. I hear about the issue of translation, which I think is a just demand. I would think it's a type of demand that I would include generally in the idea of affirmative action, that a very discriminated group historically should have some little bit of advantage to get on certain issues, for such as translation. But what I would hate would be this just demand to be used, as Marianne said, as a bargaining chip, for example, with commercial availability or for liability of trusted entities or one of these things, and to open up this whole horse trading where we would end up losing. Because I think, just like Marcus said, this should not be horse trading. This should be about how to facilitate access to these works the best way and the easiest way. The issue of digital locks and TPMs should be very, very clear. I think the solution reached is fairly good. I would hope that language would stay the where it is. I'm very happy to hear that the publishers say today, we both want a treaty, because over the last 5 or 6 years, that hasn't been the case. So I'm very honestly saying, welcome to the club. Welcome to the club. The issue of commercial incentives, that's great, but there's nothing in this treaty that is going to take away the incentive of producing works. The fact that there's an exception, obviously, doesn't mean that it's easy to produce a formatted work. It still means that La UCLA in España, the RNIB in UK, and lots of the organizations have to go to great effort to format, and the DAISY Consortium in Bookshare. It's not easy to do it. Obviously, if the publishing community all of a sudden thinks this is important, I think that's good. And I totally agree with what Pranish said about sighted people. We can go to the library and get out a book that's commercially available, and we get it out for free. And no library is going to be held accountable because that book is commercially available at the bookshop down the road. Why should it be any different for visually impaired people? So, I don't believe that this treaty, and I'll end quickly, is about chipping away at a system that has worked very well. I think totally the contrary. I think it's about placing a bit of common sense and rationality into a system that, unfortunately, has extremely low level of social acceptance, at least in Europe, and probably in most of the southern world. It's not very legitimized. And it's being violated massively. So I think the way to give it some social acceptance and some legitimation is not just defending tooth and nail on as in a lager with a wagon train, you know, everyone defending themselves, but it's about making logical exceptions that are easy to work and flexibilities, like fair use that most of the industry is against, that yes, will even increase social acceptance and legitimize this global copyright system. So this is about making reality of copyright law a little bit closer to social reality. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David. Since Marcus, and you both, Marcus, the end of his, the follow-up question I asked him, and you just now, speaking on fair use, I was wondering if you just want to take a minute to explain why you think that fair use is important in this treaty.
Well, we have been subject over the last few years on this issue to the massive hypocrisy. Massive hypocrisy and double standards of the US and the EU on a whole series of things. They say, do as we say, but don't do as we do. And because in the United States they have fair use and fair practices, which is the basis of some tremendously successful businesses that, you know, are the biggest all over the world. And it works pretty well for them, this fair use, but they don't want to hear about it in an international treaty for blind people. I don't know why. In the European Union, only one of the 27 member states has commercial availability rules. Only one, and it's not even applied, which is in UK. Nevertheless, they don't even want to hear, they don't want to hear about a treaty that doesn't have commercial availability in it. When all of the exceptions to copyright for visually impaired in the European countries work perfectly without that. And I mean, without saying, both in the US and the EU, the exceptions to copyright for the visually impaired are very simple systems. They're not even long, they're not complicated, they're not bureaucratic. Why isn't that good enough for the rest of the world?